Hi, I'm David Eilers with the University of South Florida Water Institute. Today we're going to discuss bathymetric mapping and how we use it here at the Water Institute. Bathymetric mapping creates a 3D map of the bottom depth and other structures that are in the water here at Lake Carroll. We're going to go ahead and go to the boat and see some of the equipment that we're going to use today. So let's see our equipment. So today we're using a Lowrance HDS-5. This is the Generation 2. This is actually an older unit as far as Lowrance goes, but it has everything that we need. The most important thing of all, SD card. Gotta save your data. So as far as the unit goes, we have our main unit, which obviously most everything connects to the back of. We also have our transducers here. So the transducers for sonar are shooting basically really small sound waves down to the bottom, and then it's reading the time and the strength of the signal that bounces back and determining how deep it is, and also kind of the strength of the return can tell you many things about submerged vegetation, bottom composition, and other things. We have actually, where these would normally be mounted to the back of a boat, we've actually mounted it to a pole on an old trolling motor so that we can mount it to the front of the boat, and we also use several different boats, so we need to have a mobile option. So this is a traditional transducer that is going to shoot directly underneath the boat. This longer one is a side scan transducer. So this is actually shooting off to the sides of the boat, left and right, and collecting data that would be in between our two transects. So this is our external GPS unit. This is the LGC 4000 from Lowrance. So this unit actually has an internal GPS unit. However, we don't necessarily want to put this directly above our transducers and hang it off the side of our boat. So we use the external, which gets very good satellite coverage and good accuracy, and we can mount it directly on top of it like that, so that we have direct correlation between where our GPS signal and points are coming in and where our sonar signal is coming in, which is very important. So inside the box, we normally put our battery in here, and then we have what's called the structure scan box. So this is the box that's actually taking in the data from our side scan transducer and putting it all together and stitching it essentially into a mosaic in real time and displaying it here on the main Lowrance unit. So let's go ahead and put it on the boat and run some transects. So traditionally, these kinds of transducers would be mounted to the back of the boat. However, we have found that for doing this kind of work, it's much easier to mount it to the front of the boat. This is due to having less noise from the actual boat in our data at the end of the day. With the side scan transducer, it's shooting at a very shallow angle to the left and right of the boat. If you mounted it to the back of the boat, one side is going to be shaded out by the actual motor of the boat. So putting it on the front of the boat gives us nice clean water with low turbulence to get best data that we can get. The traditional transducer, it could be mounted to the back, but we want them both mounted to the same spot so that we have good correlation with our GPS data. So it's important when you're mounting your transducers to make sure that they're going to end up being parallel to the bottom. You also want the side scan transducer to be slightly lower than your traditional transducer for the same reason that we don't want to mount it to the back of the boat where it gets shadowed by the outboard motor. We also don't want it shadowed by the other transducer. So about like this is about perfect. Again, we're going to mount the external GPS directly above, and then we're going to go ahead and start hooking up our wires. So our traditional transducer just goes into the back of the unit, while the side scan transducer goes into that Lowrance structure scan box. And then obviously supply power to the unit. any luck, it'll turn on. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to go and make sure that our transducers are reading depth properly before we start collecting data. The other thing that we're going to do is check our satellite telemetry and make sure that we've got a sufficient number of satellites. Of course, this day and age with the number of GPS satellites out there, it's usually not an issue anymore. But at times you can end up with some bad satellite telemetry, which will give you errors in your GPS coordinates, which we'd like to avoid. So what we want to do is we're going to use this as kind of a target, if you will. So I'm going to go ahead and measure the depth here just to this side of the buoy. So it's about 11.6 feet deep here next to the buoy. So now we're going to look at the sonar unit and turn it and make sure that it's reading somewhere in the vicinity of 11.6 feet while we're moving. Obviously, when we're sitting still, the transducers aren't quite going to be at the same depth in the water as when we're moving. So we need to make sure that it's reading properly in the conditions with everything loaded in the boat as when we're collecting the bathymetry data. So as we saw, when we got right up to the buoy, it was about 11.4 to 11.5 feet deep. That's within the range of tolerance for depth on it. There are a couple adjustments that we could make to the actual sonar unit to read a little bit more accurately. So we measured it at being 11.6 feet deep. The transducers and sonar unit had it at 11.4. So we've got about 0.2 of a foot difference in there. So what we can do is we can adjust what's called the keel offset, which is an adjustment in the sonar unit that adjusts for the distance of the water above where the transducers are in the water. So we'll go ahead and adjust that so that we'll get better data. So an important piece of information that we need to collect anytime we're doing bathymetry is that we need to know what the current elevation of the water level is. You need this data because although we're reading everything in absolute depth, so say 10 feet, a spot that is 10 feet deep now is going to be different than a depth at during a time of drought, or say at the end of the summertime when the water levels are much higher. So Southwest Florida Water Management District on many of the lakes has a staff gauge. So it goes ahead and tells you what the datum that they're currently using is, obviously their station name, and then it has your list of what the water depths are. So you can see down here at the bottom, the water level is currently 33.72 feet above sea level, NAVD 1988. You can see that they have also gone ahead, and if you wanted to convert your data to NGVD 29, you would simply add 0.9 feet to whatever the gauge reading is currently. This helps in data usability if you have older legacy data or newer data. This data is also very important to have this if we want to take our depth map and instead of representing the lake depths in feet, or just saying the absolute depth, we can actually change it into elevations. So instead of saying something is 20 feet deep, we can say that at that spot it is 12.2 feet above sea level. This is very important, is necessary if you're going to do further things other than just making a depth map, like say modeling flooding. If you wanted to do that, you could take the LiDAR DEM surrounding the lake and you could actually create a DEM of the water body itself using the depth converted to elevation and tie it to the surrounding land, and then model how the water body will fill at different water levels.
To collect complete bathymetric data for the lake, parallel transects are driven in the boat while logging data. The transects are orientated perpendicular to the longest axis of the lake. The spacing between transects depends on the size of the lake and the complexity of bottom depths. For example, in Lake Carroll, transects are spaced approximately 75 feet in open water and 40 feet in small bays.
So one thing that we can use the sonar data for is for analyzing the submerged vegetation community. In many places, you're going to see on the sonar screen what looks to be a very jagged bottom of spikes, and that's actually the submerged vegetation. As we head into deeper water, you'll notice an area where, as it slopes off, suddenly those vegetation spikes get very small, and then they're non-existent. That really helps with management of the lake, because then we can determine the deep water extent of the submerged vegetation community. This is very important biologically, as it's the submerged vegetation is where your small game fish and also macroinvertebrates are living, and also used for nutrient control in the lakes. The submerged vegetation are actively taking up phosphorus and nitrogen out of the water column and out of the sediments, and keeping it from being dominated by phytoplankton, which is what you see in very green lakes, that nice, rich green phytoplankton. So the submerged aquatic vegetation has a very large role in the biologic functioning of lakes such as Lake Carroll here in Hillsborough County. And that'll wrap up our field portion of bathymetric mapping. Let's go to the office and see what kind of data we found.